What have I done? I woke up in a complete panic in the middle of the night, and I looked at the clock, 3:34 in the morning. Irrationality, we all know, is at its most intense in the middle of the night. All of our fears, all of our threats feel even worse. But somehow I knew that this feeling of anxiety, it wasn't going to go away anytime soon. Because the day before, Tommy and I had just sat down with Imran and Lauren and did a big interview story with the Business of Fashion, announcing that Tommy would be shifting to the See Now, Buy Now runway model. Well, it's not there. There it is, but the headline's being swallowed by the Voices letters. This was a really, really big move for our company. In 6 months' time, we had an ambition that every single look on that runway would be available globally and on shop floors at the same time for our consumers all around the world. It was going to be a change to pretty much everything that we did and every way that we worked. It was a very big transformation for our organization. So that part was true. But what was also true is that we actually didn't know exactly how we were going to pull this off. A lot of anxiety behind that one. The good news was that Tommy and I have talked about making this step for years. It really wasn't a new idea to us. We always wanted to make our runway shows more for the public. How could we make fashion and its amazing experiences more entertaining, more democratic, more accessible for people? We really wanted to bring that to life, and we had a belief, a deep belief, that this was probably going to be the right step and move for our brand. But business has shown, historically, that the normal cycle is shaped more like an S-curve. There's the initial launch and leap into the unknown, the entrepreneurial spirit that's required before you start climbing up that mountain, fighting the battles along the way until, hopefully, you reach the summit. And finally, if success has been achieved, maybe you can relax. But actually, there's sometimes the hardest choice of all. Are we going to stay in that safe zone and hope that that slope keeps continuing upwards? Or are we going to take the plunge again and take the leap into reinventing and redefining our brand? There are a lot of really once great companies out there that have made the mistake of convincing themselves that they don't actually have to take that leap. They thought their future would look a lot like their past, and I think from everything we saw this morning, that's not what's happening in this world anymore. But I worried about this a lot in those sleepless nights and days. Were we brave enough as an organization to really take this leap? Did we actually need to take the jump? I mean, our business was doing pretty well, very well, actually. And why didn't we just wait and see how this shook out and see what everyone else did? But we are in this incredible time of transition. Our industry is obviously in a state of flux. Consumers' behaviors and mindsets are changing by the minute. And we really felt that if there was ever a time to be disruptive, this was it. Because the status quo can be a very tempting, but a very dangerous illusion. Clinging on to just what is working in that moment can suddenly be, or slowly be, the death of your business, and we just didn't want that to happen. So we felt that the bigger risk was actually to stand still, and instead we took the leap and went jumping off the cliff. And when that decision was made, we realized that we needed a process to make sure that we had the safest, smoothest landing possible. We needed the equivalent of what skydivers use when they're jumping out of the plane, aiming on that X miles below, hoping for a safe landing. We had to build a parachute that we hoped, and a process that would really maximize our chances for success. Because in just 6 months' time, we would be standing in front of a highly public audience of our peers, our industry, our customers, and at least a billion or so consumer impressions, ready to judge what this looked like. So we had to be really smart about the process, and I'd like to take you through at least how we built this parachute in 6 months' time. There were about four key steps, and the first of those steps was really about unlocking our entrepreneurial spirit that I think all of us probably have in our organizations and certainly inside of ourselves. So Tommy Hilfiger is not a small company, you might have guessed. It's a big organization. It's kind of like an oil tanker, and it is really not easy to turn one of these things, and that's what we were setting out to do in a really short period of time. But the great news is that we actually have a really entrepreneurial soul in our organization. And in taking this stand for see now, buy now, we really wanted to unlock and reignite that soul and spirit in our people. It's an easy thing to say, but it's really not an easy thing to do. So to fight our own tendencies early on, we made a pretty key decision. First of all, we were going to go all in on this platform. This was not a halfway thing. We were fully committed. And secondly, we decided that we would launch this very publicly. With that came the very real risk, though, of failing very publicly. But what that did was it really forced us outside of our comfort zone. It forced us to be much more courageous in what we were willing to do. Because we had really big ambitions. We wanted to reposition our entire women's business and bring a whole range of new fans to the brand. But when you have already, as a starting point, a $500 million women's business, you have to seriously dream big and think big in order to move that needle. So we really needed to mobilize and stimulate our people in a totally different way. And we had to be open to the fact that new ideas and solutions could come from anywhere and from anybody. And once the people in our teams started to realize that good ideas could come from anywhere, they started being really brave and coming up with amazing things. Inner entrepreneurs really started flying and ideas were flowing. And we discovered that there was talent and capability we didn't even know existed in our organization. The second big step was about learning and making sure that we invested in our partners. At first, we viewed the significant wholesale presence that we have as a company as a possible barrier or maybe even a contradiction to this see now, buy now experience. But then we flipped our thinking and we realized that there was a way we could make a real asset out of that. Because we have long and strong relationships with our retail partners, and we wanted to make sure that we were bringing our consumers who shopped in their channels as much of a great experience as we could do with consumers who shop in our own channels. So we went about bringing them into the fold very early on. We had to commit, therefore, really early in a traditional runway process to what the collection and the assortment would look like. That wasn't something that was easy to do, but we had to hit the right buying timelines for our partners. We tailored a lot of our content to make sure all of them could leverage the Tommy Now platform around their buys and around all of their specific consumers. When we launched a fast-track production cycle, we actually did it originally for our own channels, and we found that a lot of our wholesale partners were really interested to get on board. So it really showed us there was a like-minded thinking in trying to move forward and get closer to the market and get closer to consumers. Then we launched the super speed production model. Thank you, Tommy, for adding last-minute styles to the show. And we had to ask miracles of our most important vendors. But somehow they really pulled it off. In some cases, they had to produce hundreds of styles and get it from the factory to the shop floor in a 6-week time period, which is no small feat for an organization of our size. But really finding a way to crack all of this on terms that worked for our wholesale partners ended up being an incredibly strong asset for us, and it gave an amazing scale to this program. Because we were able to truly deliver on the see now, buy now promise in a way that hasn't really been seen in this scale before in the more premium segment of the market. We also invested heavily in a lot of different partnerships and collaborations in the digital and tech space, because obviously that's where the world is going and that's how people want to shop today. So we tested a lot of different digital commerce innovations because we wanted to learn about how consumers are really behaving through these different experiences. We launched interactive digital selling screens at the location where the show took place and in different cities. We made all of our social media channels and the live stream shoppable. And one of the really exciting things that we did was to partner with Facebook on the first ever AI-powered conversational commerce chatbot. That's a mouthful. Can't believe it all came out in one go. But a lot of people think, actually, that conversational commerce is the future, possibly, of e-commerce. It's pretty interesting. It's commerce that's done on WeChat and WhatsApp because it's very, very personal and engaging. And one of many such learnings for us was the realization that people were coming to this and spending almost 5 minutes engaging, and 87% of people came back for more. So we had a lot of amazing learnings like this in the digital space and the commerce space because we tested multiple avenues and we didn't put all of our eggs into one basket. So an initiative of this scale and size requires a tremendous amount of collaboration, and collaboration with teams that have never worked so early together before, in some cases teams that never even worked together before. This was a highly complex logistical exercise. We're talking about trying to get 4 million products that was produced over 3 different production waves around the world on shop floors on the same day at the same time. We had to establish a new cross-functional team just to keep transparency going because there were so many mechanics and moving parts happening throughout. In the typical process, we all know it leads, of course, with the collection and the show and then into selling, and then the marketing machine comes in at the end to bring it home to consumers. It's like a relay race where there's a really intense sprint handled by one team before the baton gets handed over to the next. But in our model, this all had to be happening simultaneously, which had never happened before for anyone. So while the graphics were being completed on the collection, for example, we were still designing and in the middle of designing the floor fixtures, the window concepts, the labels, and the hang tags. We actually had to shoot the campaign before we sold in the collection. And in some cases, we were even selling in additional fast-track pieces before we had even completed the designs on them. It was an amazing exercise that required a lot of trust and a lot of elimination of silos, which is something that you can find a lot of in a big organization. But people were really coming along with us on this journey, partly because we had a strong foundation. The first production process was done in our usual way and timelines, and that confidence gave a lot of people the ability to be more innovative and to rethink what this whole thing could look like. But in the end, there was a lot of ego that needed to be let go. We had to empower people and really trust and, in some ways, honestly, let go a little bit of being perfect and trust that we had great teams who had a great drive to make this work and let it go until the finish line. I'm not done. Are you done? But I would be remiss, because this is a super important part, if I didn't address what we call internally the Gigi effect. There is no question that Gigi Hadid has been an incredibly important partner for us, and she's added a tremendous amount of visibility and presence to this whole initiative. But it didn't all just happen coincidentally that we did this show thing and Gigi all at the same time. We intentionally pivoted into this see now, buy now model with Gigi at the heart because we really believe that she represents the new woman that we wanted to be connecting with. She represents this new demand for social immediacy and this new demand for buy now, wear now. She was the perfect partner for us to help relaunch the women's business because we didn't want to just talk about being relevant. We wanted to be relevant for our consumers. And we felt that the best way to do that was to be able to deliver to them what they would want in their hands the day that that collaborative collection launched last September. We're pretty lucky because Tommy has an uncanny ability to sniff out pop culture superstars when they're on the rise and up the slope. And just as a small note, when we started working together with Gigi, she had 3 million fans in her Instagram following. Flash forward about 16 months, and I think today it's at about 30 million. So it's been amazing, and that uncanny deep instinct and ability to trust, the courage to go there, and the desire on both sides to really partner and build something authentic, something that has real heart and a real relationship behind it, I believe has been a very powerful component of why this initiative has had so much effect. So after all of this, we built the parachute. What actually happened in the end? Let's take a look at Pier 69 in New York, 6 months after my first of many sleepless nights. To admit, and I didn't even expect this, but all of the KPIs that we set for ourselves, we seriously exceeded. And I don't want to go into lots of detail today because much of it has already been reported in the media. But I want to share a couple of findings because we are continuing to really learn a lot every day about this very dynamic platform that we think is going to keep changing. The great news for us is that the business today, globally in women's, is 20% more in terms of sellout versus the prior year. And we're really driving a lot of our higher level product offerings, which shows that that is really desirable and sticky with consumers. We found with a lot of our key wholesale partners, after only 8 weeks of having the product on the floor, they were at 60% sell-through, which is a really fantastic result. One of the most interesting learnings actually was around consumer behavior and purchase behavior around the see now, buy now. This day in New York, for those of you who weren't there, it was the hottest, most disgusting weather day in New York City ever. It must have been 100 degrees. And one of the main drivers of the entire collection was outerwear. It's fall collection. But believe it or not, outerwear was the lead selling category on location that day and in all the weeks that followed, despite the fact that we had one of the most warm Septembers on record. So I think it really shows that demand and desire for instant gratification of what you see, and if you really love it, it does trump the practicality of weather and see now, buy now. So there's an interesting mix there. In social media, we found we had 2 billion impressions, but only 20% of those were generated by our own posts. So all that conversation, I think, really shows that people are really interested in these experiences and in amazing immediacy. When we tailored the platform to make sure that it worked on a local basis, for example, in China, we also found that we had a lot of traction. The shoppable livestream video that we played on Tmall, hosted by Liu Wen, it aired in China at 7 a.m. in the morning, so we didn't have very high expectations. But 4 million viewers watched it, and it was the number one watched show on Tmall that day. And the traffic to Tommy.com on Tmall thereafter was 300% up over prior year. And on the Tommy.com US website, we were up 900% over prior year, which is astounding. But more excitingly, 70% of those people were new to the brand. So I really think it shows with this more youthful-oriented customer really what they're looking for, and there's a lesson there that could be learned for all of us. So tons of learnings, and we're really, really happy, of course, that it worked out. But just a few final notes of, I think, what the most important things for us are. The realization was, for me personally, that Tommy Now and this type of a platform, it's no longer a runway show. And we can't think about it as a traditional runway show. It's a media platform, and it's a content platform, and it's built around the consumer. And the other very unexpected learning, which is slightly terrifying a little bit, was how do you follow success? Because we weren't even sure if we were going to have success. But in some ways, when that happens, it becomes even more daunting than the unknown mountain that we set out to conquer 6 months earlier. And if you follow your news, and I know everyone here does, you have a little bit of a hint of where that's going to be going. But we believe that we just have to keep evolving and testing and learning, and that this is not a static platform because we don't have a static consumer. And as long as their behavior is changing, we need to keep up with that change and continue to evolve with it. And we have to retain the guts to just keep pushing ourselves outside of our safety zone. For us, this has become a really inspiring innovation platform on a very grand scale. But whether or not this particular model is right for you or for your business, I think the biggest learning of all has been about the power of embracing risk again and the incredible liberation that can come from that. It's been truly transformative for me personally and in our whole organization. It's really expedited and put the gas pedal on for us to think about innovating in totally different ways in every area of the company, whether it's the retail experience, digital selling, digital commerce, or any of the above. And I think in this incredible time of flux and transformation that we know we are all in this world and in this industry, maybe it's actually the safest time to shake up our system. With all the rules moving around, maybe this is the time to just throw out the rule book. Because if we don't test and learn, we are never going to move forward. We cannot sit by and let our industry stagnate while people and consumers shift their attention into experiences or travel or food or entertainment. We have to keep them interested and connected and emotionally wanting to be in our world. And I believe that we can all be disruptors, and we can all support each other on that. We can actually share learnings with each other. We can forge new paths and explore new ways to make sure that we keep fashion exciting and completely engaging. It's actually kind of liberating, I think, to be in a time where we can completely rewrite the rules of our industry. And there is no wrong way or right way. There's a lot of ways in between, but I think what's essential is about continuing to push forward and break new boundaries so we can keep pace with this crazy changing world. And in the end, the consumers will decide.